Hey guys, and welcome back to another reading of Harry Potter. We are about ready to start chapter 14, Norbit and the Norwegian Ridgeback. Okay, this chapter is going to be about 17 minutes, so it'll probably take me between 18 and 20 minutes to read it. And I hope you guys are enjoying these sessions. I've been enjoying reading the book as well. And let's go ahead and get started. Chapter 14, Norbit and the Norwegian Ridgeback. Quirrell, however, must have been braver than they thought. In the weeks that followed, he did seem to be getting paler and thinner, but it didn't look as though he's cracked yet. Every time they passed the third floor corridor, Harry, Ron, and Hermione would press their ears to the door to check that Fluffy was still growling inside. Snape was sweeping about in his usual bad temper, which surely meant that the stone was still safe. Whenever Harry passed Quirrell these days, he gave him an encouraging sort of smile, and Ron had started telling people off for laughing at Quirrell's stutter. Hermione, however, had more on her mind than the Sorcerer's Stone. She had started drawing up study schedules and color-coding all of her notes. Harry and Ron wouldn't have minded, but she kept nagging them to do the same. "Hermione, the exams are ages away."
10 weeks, Hermione snapped. "That's not ages at all. That's like a second to Nicholas Flamel."
"But we're not 600 years old," Ron reminded her. "Anyway, what are you studying for already? You already know it all."
"What am I studying for? Are you crazy? Do you realize that we need to pass the exams to get to the second year, right? They're kind of important. I should have started studying a month ago. I didn't know what's gotten into me."
Unfortunately, the teachers seemed to be thinking along the same lines as Hermione. They piled so much homework on them that the Easter holidays weren't nearly as much fun as the Christmas ones. It was hard to relax with Hermione next to you reciting the 12 uses of dragon's blood or practicing wand movements. Moaning and yawning, Harry and Ron spent most of their free time in the library with her, trying to get through all their extra work.
"I'll never remember this," Ron burst out one afternoon, throwing down his quill and looking longingly out the library window.
It was the first really fine day they've had in months. The sky was clear, forget-me-not blue, and there was a feeling in the air of summer coming. Harry, who was looking up Dittany in 1,000 Magical Herbs and Fungi, didn't look up until he heard Ron say,
"Hagrid, what are you doing in the library?"
Hagrid shuffled into view, hiding something behind his back. He looked very out of place in his moleskin overcoat.
"Just looking," he said in a shifty voice that got their interest at once.
"And what you looking up there?" He looked suddenly suspicious.
"You're not still looking for Nicholas Flamel, are you?"
I don't know why I give him like an Irish accent. It's just weird. Sorry about that.
We found out who he was ages ago," said Ron impressively. "And we know what the dog is guarding. It's the Sorcerer's
Shh. Hagrid looked around quickly to see if anyone was listening.
"Don't go shouting about it. What's the matter with you?"
"There are a few things we wanted to ask you, as a matter of fact," said Harry, "about guarding the stone apart from Fluffy."
"Shh," said Hagrid again. "Listen. Come and see me later. I'm not promising I'll tell you anything, mind, but don't go rabbiting about in here. Students aren't even supposed to know. They'll think I've told you."
"See you later, then," said Harry. Hagrid shuffled off. "What was he hiding behind his back?" said Hermione thoughtfully. "Do you think it had anything to do with the stone?"
"I'm going to see what section he was in," said Ron, who had enough of working.
He came back a minute later with a pile of books in his arms and slammed them down on the table.
"Dragons," he said. "Hagrid was looking up stuff about dragons. Look at these. Dragon species of Great Britain and Ireland. From Egg to Inferno, a Dragon Keeper's Guide."
"Hagrid always wanted a dragon. He told me so the first time we ever met," said Harry.
But it's against the law," said Ron. "Dragon breeding was outlawed by the Warlocks Convention of 1709. Everyone knows that. It's hard to stop muggles from noticing us if we keep dragons in the back garden. Anyway, you can't tame dragons. It's dangerous. You should see the burns Charlie got off the wild ones in Romania."
"But there aren't wild dragons in Britain," said Harry.
"Of course there are," said Ron.
"Common Welsh green and Hebridean blacks. The Ministry of Magic has a job of hushing them up, I can tell you. Our kind have to keep putting spells on muggles who spotted them to make them forget."
"So what on earth is Hagrid up to?" said Hermione.
When they knocked on the door of the gamekeeper's hut an hour later, they were surprised to see that all the curtains were closed. Hagrid called,
"Who is it?"
before he let them in, and then shut the door quickly behind them. It was stifling hot inside. Even though it was such a warm day, there was a blazing fire in the grate. Hagrid made them tea and offered them
stout sandwiches, which they refused. "So, you want to ask me something?"
"Yes," said Harry. "There's no point in beating around the bush. We were wondering if you could tell us what's guarding the Sorcerer's Stone, apart from Fluffy."
Hagrid frowned at him.
"Of course I can't," he said. "Number one, I don't know myself. Number two, you know too much already. I wouldn't tell you if I could. That stone here is here for a good reason. It was almost stolen out of Gringotts. I suppose you would have worked that out and all. Beats me how you even know about Fluffy."
"Oh, come on, Hagrid. You might not want to tell us, but you do know. You know everything that goes on around here," said Hermione in a warm, flattering voice. Hagrid's beard twitched, and they could tell he was smiling. "We only wondered who had done the guarding, really," Hermione went on. "We wondered who Dumbledore had trusted enough to help him, apart from you."
Hagrid's chest swelled at the last words. Harry and Ron beamed at Hermione.
"Well, I don't suppose it could hurt you, to tell you that. Let's see. He borrowed Fluffy from me, and then some of the teachers did enchantments. Professor Sprout, Professor Flitwick, Professor McGonagall, he ticked them off his fingers. Professor Quirrell, and Dumbledore himself did something, of course. Hang on, I've forgotten someone. Oh yeah, Professor Snape."
"Snape?"
"Yeah, you're still not on about him, are you? Look, Snape helped protect the stone. He's not about to steal it."
Harry knew Ron and Hermione were thinking the same as he was. If Snape had been on protecting the stone, it must have been easy to find out how the other teachers had guarded it. He probably knew everything except seeing Quirrell's spell and how to get past Fluffy.
"You're the only one who knows how to get past Fluffy, aren't you, Hagrid?" said Harry anxiously. "And you wouldn't tell anyone, would you? Not even one of the teachers?"
"Not a soul knows except me and Dumbledore," said Hagrid proudly.
"Well, that's something," Harry muttered to the others.
"Hagrid, can we have a window open? I'm boiling."
"Can't, Harry. Sorry," said Hagrid.
Harry noticed him glance at the fire. Harry looked at it, too.
"Hagrid, what is that?"
But he already knew what it was. In the very heart of the fire, under the kettle, was a huge black egg.
"Ah," said Hagrid, fidgeting nervously with the beard. "That's her."
"Where did you get that, Hagrid?" said Ron, crouching over the fire to get a closer look at the egg. "It must have cost you a fortune."
"I won it," said Hagrid. "Last night, I was down in the village having a few drinks and a game of cards with a stranger. I think he was quite glad to get rid of it, to be honest."
"But what are you doing with it? What are you going to do when it hatches?" said Hermione.
"Well, I've been doing some reading," said Hagrid, pulling a large book from under his pillow. "Got this out of the library, Dragon Breeding for Pleasure and Profit. It's a bit out of date, of course, but it's all in here. Keep the egg in the fire, because the mothers breathe on them, see? And when it hatches, feed it a bucket of brandy mixed with chicken blood every half hour. And see here? How to recognize the different eggs? What I got here is a Norwegian Ridgeback. They're rare."
He looked very pleased with himself, but Hermione didn't.
"Hagrid, you live in a wooden house," she said.
But Hagrid wasn't listening. He was humming merrily, so as he stoked the fire. So, now they had something else to worry about. What might happen to Hagrid if anyone found out he was holding an illegal dragon in his hut?
"Wonder what it's like to have a peaceful life," Ron said, sighed. "That is after the evening they struggled through..." Oh my gosh, let me start that whole sentence over. Ron sighed as evening after evening they struggled through all the extra homework they were getting. Hermione had now started making study schedules for Harry and Ron too. It was driving them nuts. Then one breakfast time, Hedwig brought Harry another note from Hagrid. It had written on it only two words. "It's hatching." Ron wanted to skip herbology and go straight down to the hut. Hermione wouldn't hear of it.
"Hermione, how many times in our lives are we going to see a dragon hatching?
We've got lessons. We'll get in trouble. And that's nothing to what Hagrid's going to be in if someone finds out what he's doing."
"Be quiet," Harry whispered.
Malfoy was only a few feet away, and he had stopped dead to listen. How much had he heard? Terry didn't like the look on Malfoy's face at all. Ron and Hermione argued all the way to herbology, and in the end, Hermione agreed to run down to Hagrid's with the two during morning break. When the bell sounded from the castle at the end of their lesson, the three of them dropped their towels at once and hurried through the grounds to the edge of the forest. Hagrid greeted them, looking flushed and excited.
"It's nearly out," he ushered them inside. The egg was lying on the table. There were deep cracks in it. Something was moving inside. A funny clicking noise was coming from it. They all drew their chairs up to the table and watched with bated breath. All at once, there was a scraping noise, and then the egg split open. The baby dragon flopped on the table. It wasn't exactly pretty. Harry thought it looked kind of like a crumpled black umbrella. Its spiny wings were huge compared to its skinny jet body. It had a long snout with wide nostrils and the stubs of horns and
bulging orange eyes. It sneezed. A couple of sparks flew out of its snout.
"Isn't he beautiful?" Hagar murmured.
He reached out a hand to stroke the dragon's head. It snapped at his fingers, showing its pointed fangs.
"Bless him! Look, he knows his mummy," said Hagrid.
"Hagrid," said Hermione, "how fast do Norwegian Ridgebacks grow exactly?" Hagrid was about to answer when the color suddenly drained from his face. He leaped to his feet and ran to the window.
"What's the matter?" "Someone was looking through the gap in the curtain. It's a kid. He's running. Back up to your school."
Harry bolted to the door and looked out. Even at a distance, there was no mistaking him. Malfoy had seen the dragon. Something about the smile lurking on Malfoy's face during the next week made Harry, Ron, and Hermione very nervous. They spent most of their free time in Hagrid's darkened hut trying to reason with him.
"Just let him go," Harry urged. "Set him free." "I can't," said Hagrid. "He's too little. He'll die."
They looked at the dragon. It had grown 3 times the length in just a week. Smoke leapt.
No. Just a second. Sorry, guys.
Sorry guys, Cat was freaking out, so I had to do this in 2 sittings. Hagrid hadn't been doing his gamekeeping duties because the dragon was keeping him so busy. There were empty brandy bottles and chicken feathers all over the floor.
"I've decided to call him Norbit," said Hagrid, looking at the dragon with misty eyes. "He really knows me now. Watch! Norbit! Norbit! Where's Mummy?"
"He's lost his marbles," muttered Ron in Harry's ear. "Hagrid," said Harry loudly, "give it 2 weeks and Norbit's going to be as long as your house. Malfoy could go to Dumbledore at any moment." Hagrid bit his lip.
I know. I can't keep him forever, but I can't just dump him. He can't."
Harry suddenly turned to Ron.
"Charlie," he said.
"You're losing it too," said Ron.
"I'm Ron, remember?"
"No, Charlie. Your brother, Charlie, in Romania, studying dragons. We could send Norbit to him. Charlie can take care of him and then put him back in the wild."
"Brilliant," said Ron.
"How about it, Hagrid?" And at the end of the day, Hagrid agreed that they could send an owl to Charlie and ask him. The following week dragged by. Wednesday night found Hermione and Harry sitting all alone in the common room long after everyone had gone to bed. The clock on the wall had just chimed midnight when the portrait burst open. Ron appeared out of nowhere as he pulled off Harry's invisibility cloak. He had been down at Hagrid's hut, helping him feed Norbit, who was now eating dead rats by the crate.
"It bit me," he said, showing them his hand, which was wrapped in a bloody handkerchief. "I'm not going to be able to hold a quill for a week. I tell you, that dragon's the most horrible animal I've ever met, but the way Hagrid goes on about it, you'd think it was a fluffy little bunny rabbit. When it bit me, he told me I frightened it, and when I left, he was singing it a lullaby."
There was a tap on the dark window. "It's Hedwig," said Harry, hurrying in.
"She'll have Charlie's answer."
The three of them put their heads together and read the note. "Dear Ron, how are you? Thanks for the letter. I'd be glad to take the Norwegian Ridgeback, but it won't be easy getting him here. I think the best thing will be to send him over with some friends of mine who are coming to visit me next week. Trouble is, they mustn't see me carrying an illegal dragon. Could you get the Ridgeback up to the tallest tower by midnight on Saturday? They can meet you there and take him while it's still dark. Send me an answer as soon as possible. Love, Charlie." They looked at one another.
"We've got an invisibility cloak," said Harry. "It shouldn't be too difficult."
"I think the cloak is big enough to cover the two of us," said Norbit. "Two of us and Norbit." It was a mark of how bad the last week had been that the other two agreed with them. Anything to get rid of Norbit and Malfoy. There was a hitch. By the next morning, Ron's bitten hand had swollen twice the size as usual. He didn't know whether it was safe to go to Madame Pomfrey. Would she recognize the dragon bite? By the afternoon, though, he had no choice. The cut had turned into a nasty shade of green. It looked as if Norbit's fangs were poisonous. Harry and Hermione rushed up to the hospital wing at the end of the day to find Ron in a terrible state in bed.
"It's not just my hand," he whispered, "although that feels like it's about to fall off. Malfoy told Madame Pomfrey he wanted to borrow one of my books so he could come over and have a good laugh at me. He was threatening to tell her what had bit me. I told her it was a dog, but I don't think she believes me. I shouldn't have hit him at the Quidditch match. That's why he's doing this.
Harry and Hermione tried to calm Ron down. "It'll be all over by midnight on Saturday," said Hermione. But this didn't soothe Ron at all. On the contrary, he sat bolt upright and broke into a sweat.
"Midnight on Saturday," he said in a hoarse voice. Oh no, I just remembered. Charlie's letter was in the book Malfoy took. He's going to know we're getting rid of Norbit."
Harry and Hermione didn't get a chance to answer. Madame Pomfrey came over that moment and made them leave, saying Ron needed some sleep.
"It's too late to change the plan now," Harry told Hermione. "We haven't got time to send another owl. This could be our only chance to get rid of Norbit. We'll have to risk it. And we have got the invisibility cloak. Malfoy doesn't know about that."
They found Fang, the boarhound, sitting outside with a bandaged tail when they went to tell Hagrid, who opened the window to talk to them.
"I won't let you in," he puffed. "Norbit's at a tricky stage. Nothing I can't handle, though."
When they told him about Charlie's letter, his eyes filled with tears, although that might have been because Norbit had just been biting his leg.
"Ah, it's all right. It's only got my boot. Just playing, because he's a baby, after all."
The baby banged its tail on the wall, making the windows rattle. Harry and Hermione walked back to the castle, feeling Saturday couldn't come quick enough. They would have felt sorry for Hagrid when the time had come to say goodbye to Norbit if they hadn't been so worried about what they were going to do. It was a very dark, cloudy night, and they were a bit late arriving at Hagrid's hut because they had to wait for Peeves to get out of their way at the entrance hall, where he'd been playing tennis against the wall. Hagrid had had Norbit packed and ready in a large crate.
"He's got lots of rats and some brandy for the journey," said Hagrid in a muffled voice. "And I packed his teddy bear in case he gets lonely."
From inside the crate came a ripping noise that sounded as though the teddy was having his head torn off.
"Bye-bye, Norbit," Hagrid sobbed as Harry and Hermione covered the crate with the invisibility cloak and stepped underneath it themselves. "Mommy will never forget you."
How they managed to get the crate back up the castle, they never knew. Midnight ticked near as they heaved Norbit up the marble staircase in the entrance hall and along the dark corridors, up another staircase and then another one, as if Harry's shortcuts didn't make the work easier.
"Nearly there," Harry panted as they reached the corridor beneath the tallest tower.
Then a sudden movement up ahead made them almost drop the crate. Forgetting they were already invisible, they shrank into the shadows, staring at the dark outlines of two people grappling with each other 10 feet away. A lamp flared. Professor McGonagall, in a tartan bathrobe and hairnet, had Malfoy by the ear.
"Detention," she shouted, "and 20 points from Slytherin. Wandering around the middle of the night. How dare you?"
"You don't understand, Professor. Harry Potter's coming. He's got a dragon."
"What utter rubbish. Rubbish. How dare you tell such lies? Come on, I shall see Professor Snape about you, Malfoy."
The steep spiral staircase up to the top of the tower seemed the easiest thing in the world after that. Not until they stepped out into the cold night did they throw off the cloak, glad to be able to breathe properly again. Hermione did a sort of jig.
"Malfoy's got detention. I could sing."
"Don't," Harry advised her. Chuckling about Malfoy, they waited, Norbit thrashing about in his crate. About 10 minutes later, 4 broomsticks came swooshing down out of the darkness. Charlie's friends were a cheery lot. They showed Harry and Hermione the harness they rigged up so they could suspend Norbit between them. They all helped buckle Norbit safely into it, and then Harry and Hermione shook hands with the others and thanked them very much. At last, Norbit was gone. Norbit was going, gone. They slipped back down the spiral staircase, their hearts as light as their hands. Now that Norbit was off them, no more dragon. Malfoy in detention. What could spoil their happiness? The answer to that was waiting for them at the foot of the stairs. Filch. He was in the corridor. His face loomed suddenly out of darkness.
Well, he whispered. We are in trouble.
They left the invisibility cloak on the top of the tower. Yikes. Okay. That's probably not good for them. We will start chapter 15 the next time we read, called The Forbidden Forest.
I hope you guys have a lovely day. I miss you, Oodle Gobs, and I love you lots.